Chrome.
OK. So it should be okay. So let's start. So now, so last time we finished by providing an example of monoidal functor between vec g omega and a natural monoidal transformation. So today we will start by talking about group action on categories and equivariantization. Group action on categories and equivariantization. Okay. So let si let si be a category so for many categories you can get a monoidal category. Consider the monoidal category hot si, where the object of this category are equivalence of categories. C to itself, the morphism are natural isomorphism, natural transformation which are natural isomorphism, and the monoidal structure is exact given by the composition. Composition. So it is a monoidal subcategory. So it's a monoidal subcategory of a category we already meet, the category of all the functor, so and of C. So this category, so the object are just functor F from C to itself. Before, this was the equivalence of category here, just functor in general. The morphism as a natural transformation, before this was natural isomorphism here, and the monoidal structure is also given by the composition. This is and of C. So hot C is a monoidal subcategory of and C. And if, so you have hot C, if C is also a monoidal category, then we can consider another a subcategory of hot C, which is hot tensor C, which is a monoidal category of monoidal equivalence of C. So you see the difference. Here it should be monoidal equivalence, and here this is just equivalence because there is no structure, monoidal structure assumed on C. But if there is one, it's better to consider this monoidal category. okay. Okay. So we need to introduce that to define the notion of group action. So now we will introduce a monoidal category related to group. So consider the monoidal category C equal cat J, with J a group. So what is the object here? The objects are just elements of G. So this is a category which is different from the category we already mentioned from group. We already mentioned the category rep G and the category vec G. But this category is in fact is different. The objects here are not vector space, but just element of G. The morphism so Om C between two elements are exactly the set with one element identity if G equal H and is empty otherwise. So you can have an empty Om set here, and the monoidal structure is exactly given by the product of the group. Now, thanks to this definition, you can define action of group. So definition, recall. So action of G on a category C is a monoidal. The monoidal functor T from cat G to hot C. So you see here we use the two notions we just defined. We just defined cat G and hot G, hot C just before. So maybe you you should not confuse maybe I should not call that C because it's not the same C. So let's call that D. Let D okay. So we define a cat G here. We define hot C here. So it's okay. So an action of G on a category C is defined as the monoidal functor T from cat G to hot C. And if the category C is monoidal, so an action of C on a monoidal on monoidal. Category C is a monoidal functor from KG to hot tensor C. So if the category is monoidal, then we should use this monoidal category to define the action. Okay. So then, this monoidal functor is there is as we said that previously, a monoidal functor is defined with a monoidal structure. So for all G and H, let gamma GH, the monoidal structure of T. So from T, G, T, H, T, G, H, be the monoidal structure. The monoidal structure of the functor. Dual structure. So you recognize the structure, the monoidal structure. Why? Because you see that here, this is the tensor product of hot C, and here, this dot is a tensor product of K. So everything is fine. Okay, so now we can define the notion of G equivariantization of a category. G equivariantization, we can define or we can recall, in fact. As I said, we are in the summary part of the course. G equivariantization of C denoted C power G. So definition. So what is the object of this G equivariantization? So the object are pairs X, U, where X is in C, an object in C, and U is a family of isomorphism UG from TG to X. G in G, such that so such that the following diagram commutes. So again, is to remove ambiguity. So you start from X. Here you apply U under TJ. So UH. And you go to TG of X. That's okay. Here you apply just UG, you get X. But here this is equal to TG compose TH of X. So we can apply the monoidal structure. gamma gh of x, and you get t gh of x. And here, we finally apply the monoidal structure. The isomorphism coming from U. Here, U G H. So you have this ambiguity. So this should commute. Such diagram commute for all G H in G. So this is the object of the G equivalentization of a category C. Such a pair. So we want to you have a category C, you have some category C, and you have a and so you want to make this you want to make this to make a G equivariant category. So you define it as a pair like that for the object, and the morphism. So let's call the morphism F tilde. Between two objects, XU and YV. So define by, so you have a morphism F from X to Y, such that the following commute. So you should avoid this ambiguity. So I have no enough space here. So I will go to the next page. Okay. So such that the following diagram commute. So T G of X. Here you apply F under TG. So TG of Y. So what's the meaning of that? Wait a minute. yeah. Here you apply UG X V G Y F. So this commute for all G in G. Okay, so we call in fact this morphism F tilde, but this is nothing for a morphism between these two objects. So you need to, it's defined as a morphism between X and Y, such that this commute. So in fact, it should be more correct to call this morphism just F. So it's some F satisfying this property. So so let me call that morphism between so morphism F morphism like such that we have this commit. Okay. And then so you define you have a category, but what we want is a monoidal category. And how to get a monoidal category? We need to consider you need C to be a monoidal category. So if C is a monoidal category, so replace hot C by hot tensor C above to get a monoidal structure of C chi. Okay. So example. So the example, the main example is the following. So if you take the trivial monoidal category, just vec, so the vector category of vector space, maybe finite dimensional vector space, then vec, so C, CG in this case is isomorphic to rep G. So the G equivariantization of the trivial monoidal category is the category rep G, which is not at all trivial. So this construction is important. Okay. So now, I forgot what. Okay, so now, definition. So we are done with this G equivalentization. Now we will consider the notion of strict monoidal category. We will provide some example, and then we will recall MacLane strictness theorem and its corollary called the coherence theorem. So a monoidal category C is called is strict if for all. So strict mean that the associativity constraint and the unit constraint are trivial, are just identity maps. So if for all x, y, z in C, you have, as I said, the associativity and unit constraint are trivial. So for so, you need first to get an equality between these two. So the in the strict monoidal categories, you have an equality. In general, you don't have an equality. It's just an isomorphism given by the associativity constraint. But to for being strict, you need an equality. And also for the unit, it's equal. But even if it is equal, you still you could still get the associativity constraint to be, in general, you can have you can have non-trivial isomorphism between two equal objects. So you need something stronger than that. We also need that the associativity and the unity constraint are identity maps. Okay. So the strict monoidal category. So example of strict monoidal category. Example of strict monoidal category. Monoidal category. So first example, canonical example, just the category of endofunctor of a category. So the monoidal category of endofunctor, so functor from C to itself, of category C. So we already mentioned this before. So the objects are functors F from C to itself. The morphism are natural transformation phi to such functor, natural transformation, and the tensor product is the composition. So we already see something like that before. Okay. So, okay. Now, the next example will be as for set. So I just note that. Now we will start the summary of last semester's course 8, session. I want to write session 8. So in last semester session 8, we started with the second example called sets with another line like that. So it's not the same category as the usual category set, because here the objects are not set but non-negative integer. So it's like set up to equivalence, if you want to know. Non-negative integer. The morphism. So, morphism F from two non-negative integers are maps from the set D7. So it's like here the objects are not set, are just non-negative integer. And you can define you can define morphism like that. So it's like for the category of tangle, it's a bit simpler than the category of tangle, For example, you can modelize M like that and N like some point like that. And the Ohm set between M and N is just the set of function between these two sets, which this can be represented just by like that. So maybe this map to this, this map here, and this map here, and this map here, etc. So you can see the, like a picture. Like that. So here, this picture makes no sense in the sense that it makes sense, but we don't need, because in fact, you can just take, instead of taking non-negative integer, you could take the object like that or like that. But you can take just a non-negative integer. And it's good to take the non-negative integer instead of set, because then the tensor product is easy, is just multiplication. And for the morphism, so if you have two morphism, F1, F2, between M1 and N1, or Fi, between Mi and Ni, so you have I equal one or two. You define F1, so the tensor product of function between M1, M2 to N1, N2, defined such that F1 tensor F2. So now you consider it as a map. So M2X plus Y. Well, N2 F1X plus F2Y, where you have X between 0 and M1 and Y between 0 and M2. So you take such. So you have so this corresponds to such a set with M equal M1, M2, etc. So you define the tensor product of map like that. So it's okay. There is no problem. Should find a better application. Okay, so remark, set this category, this monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to the usual monoidal category set S. Finite set. Category of finite set. So this is monoidally equivalent to that. And but this one, so as we said, this one is example of strict monoidal category. So you can make a strictification of this usual category like that. Then, next example, the linear version of set call kvec bar with care field. So the object as before are non-negative integer. Integers, the morphism n cross n matrices. So it's a linear version. So we replace map by matrices. And the tensor product. So you have M, E, same thing. For the object, the tensor product is just the product. But for the morphism, if you have a morphism, so a morphism we said it's a matrix. So MI cross NI matrix. F1 tensor F2 is the Kronecker product. So we define it as Kronecker product. So I don't recall the Kronecker product. We should go to the last semester material. I provided I put more details about Kronecker product. So we should go to last semester session 8. I provide a lot of examples. Okay. Idem. It is monoidally equivalent to kvec. Finite, the category of finite dimensional k vector spaces. And we can do the same. So it's also strict. We can do the same for VecG. So VecG is also monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category K VecG bar. So I don't provide details where the object are instead of being numbers, here the object are function f from g to z non negative, such that we have that of z strictly positive here should be finite. So this means that this is zero almost everywhere. Zero almost everywhere. Zero everywhere except on the finite set. Okay. So I don't provide details for the last example, but it's possible. So what is the point of providing such example of strict monoidal category? You see that this example look like the example we already mentioned before. But it's a kind of strict version of the monoidal category we mentioned before. So most, as of the usual monoidal category. So set vec vec g, etc. are non-strict but monoidally, as we just said, equivalent to strict one. And this observation, this is true in general. So this is called the MacLean strictness theorem. So I will state it after the pause. It's time for the pause. 6, 5, 2, 6, 10.
Recording.
Okay. So let me start. So I did not say, but so I did not justify why the example 1, 2, 3 are strict, in fact. But in fact, it's easy to see. It's easy to see because here, for example, for one, this is given by the composition. And when something is given by a composition, the composition is trivially associative. There is no ambiguity. Here, the for two, the tensor product is just a product of integers. So it's associative. And everything works fine with the morphism. So it's trivially strict. So all the usual monoidal categories are monoidally equivalent to strict one. And this is true in general. It's called the MacLean strictness theorem. Any monoidal category, si, is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. Then you can say, okay, so what is the point of defining the notion of monoidal category with non-trivial associativity constraint and unit constraint if everything is equivalent to something with trivial associativity constraint? In fact, we will see later, maybe today, that the strictness property is in conflict with another property called the skeletal property. So more the category is strict and less it is skeletal. And skeletal means that there is one object for in each equivalent class of object. So more you make a category strict and more you add object, etc., etc. So sometimes, most of the time, we prefer to have a category where there is one object for each equivalent class, and then that cannot be strict in general. That's why it makes sense to define general monoidal categories, which are non-strict, in particular for categorification problem, we need to use a skeletal non-strict category. Anyway, this MacLean strictness theorem is useful to prove some result some purely categorical result. So what is the ID? So I will not write the proof. The proof is also in the last semester materials, but I will still provide the ID of the proof because it's a big result. So what is the ID? The ID is to give a monoidal equivalence between C and the monoidal subcategory. And subcategory the subcategory up to forgetful functor. The subcategory of the ANDO, this category, we know this category is strict. We know that ANDC is strict. This was the example one before. So we define an equivalence between C and the subcategory of ANDC. So the subcategory of write C module functor. In other words, this functor f such that fx tensor y is isomorphic to fx tensor y. So it's write C module functor. So this is ID of the proof. And we provide, so to better understand even what I mean, a non-categorical analogous. A non-categorical analogous of that. So I mean, what is the analogous of that for monoid? Because you say monoidal category is a categorification of the notion of monoid. So every monoid, M, is isomorphic to the monoid of map F from M to M such that Fmn equal Fmn, like that, for all mn in n. So you see the same structure. You see that y go inside, n go inside like that. The same right structure. And why this is true? Why every monoid is isomorphic to the monoid of map like that? And the ID of the proof. Because you take a map, any map like that. Take a map like that. So M is just, E is a neutral. But by the structure of the map, this is nothing but FEM. So you have the function F is nothing but the left multiplication by F of E. So F, just this function F, is exactly the function of left multiplication by some element in M. So you have this bijection. You have this isomorphism. So I will not provide more details about McLane strictness theorem. go to the last semester material to really get the detailed proof. But in fact, these ideas provide you a good intuition of what happened in this detailed proof. The detailed proof is just to make all the details of that. All the ideas are there. So, details of the proof. See, last semester material. So, this was proved in session 8 and 9. And the book on section 2.8. Okay. And in fact, so last semester session 8 was mainly dedicated to this proof 8 and 9. So we skip in this summary part, we skip the detailed proofs. So last semester's session 9. This will be quick. So started with the end of the proof of McLean strictness theorem. Okay. And a remark. The remark saying that this theorem is non-trivial. It's good to mention this theorem, McLean strictness theorem, is not trivial. So a monoidal category C is always monoidally equivalent to a strict one. C tilde. So okay, this is the statement of the theorem, but not always isomorphic. Isomorphic to C tilde. So you should be careful. There is a difference between monoidal equivalence and monoidal isomorphism, between two monoidal categories. They are monoidally equivalent, but not isomorphic. And the generic counterexample is if C is not strict, is not isomorphic to C. It is monoidal equivalent, but not isomorphic. Okay, that's all for session 9. So, summary of last semester, session 10. Okay, so as I said, the process of strictification is not free in the sense that the strictification, so you get good properties, but you also get bad properties. This add a lot of objects. And sometimes it's bad to have, sometimes we prefer to have as less objects as possible. But we will see, in fact, so this McLean strictness theorem will be used to prove The coherent theorem. Coherence theorem. So it's good to prove some theoretical result in category, but in practice, we prefer to have category with as few as possible objects in equivalence class. So note that in general, a process of strictification, making strictification had a lot of object. So for example, so I will briefly mention if you consider the category vec g omega with g a group, finite group, and omega, a non-trivial omega non-trivial Suiko cycle, non-trivial up to equivalence. So we mentioned before so such equivalence. So if omega is non-trivial, C is not isomorphic to a strict monoidal category. This is not isomorphic because omega corresponds to the associativity constraint and it is non-trivial. So it cannot be isomorphic to a category with a trivial associativity constraint. A monoidal category. One strictification. So I am talking about one strictification. There is no, you can have several possible strictifications. So in the proof of Maclean's coherence theorem, you have one strictification using a subcategory of ANSI, but you can have other strictification. So one strictification of C here require to consider a surjective morphism F between some G tilde to G, where G tilde is some free group. So some free group, G is a finite group and G tilde is some free group. And for all G in G tilde, phi delta G will is a simple object of C tilde. So you see in vec G omega, the simple object are delta G with G in the group G finite. So we are finitely many simple objects up to equivalence. Here, you have much more simple object. If you have two, then this is equivalent to G1 equals G2. So there is no quotient here. You are making huge amount of new object. This is the cost. So the cost of huge amount of new object. The cost of the strictification. Amount, huge amount. It's a simple object of C. The strict one strictification. Okay. So you have many, many new objects. Wait. What I am saying. So I am saying something wrong here. If and if f, sorry, f of g1 equal f of g2, sorry. A huge amount of new object in the equivalence class. In the equivalence classes. Okay. So you have the opposite. So the opposite, in some sense, opposite process is called skeleton. Skeleton. The definition. A category is skeletal if it has only one object in each isomorphism class. Isoclass. Here it's isoclass. Isomorphism class. So you see in what it is opposite, because here you should have one object in each isomorphism class, and here you had infinitely many new objects in the isomorphism class because it's a free group. So in that sense, it's opposite. Okay. And theorem. So the opposite process is skeleton. Theorem. Any monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to a skeletal monoidal category. So such a skeletal monoidal category sometimes is called its skeleton. And the proof involves the axiom of choice. Involve the axiom of choice. So this is important to have in mind, these two opposite process, which strictification and skeleton. Sometimes it's good to have a category which is strict. Sometimes it's good to have skeletal. But it's very hard to have both. In general, you cannot have both. It's not so. A monoidal category may not be monoidally equivalent to a strict and skeletal monoidal category. So example. Example. So vec g omega has a strict skeleton. So so this this is called it's a skeleton, not a skeleton because it's not unique, maybe called a skeleton. Skeleton as a skeleton. So vec g omega has a strict skeleton if and only if, so in general you don't have, if and only if omega is trivial. So vec g has a strict skeleton. But we don't know much strict skeletal modal category except vec g. So we know very few strict skeletal monoidal category. Monoidal category. And here is a reason why. One reason why it's hard to be strict and skeletal is that a strict skeletal fusion category, the fusion category, as we said in the first class, is a categorification of the notion of fusion ring. So it's a monoidal category with some additional assumption we will see later. But it's good to put this remark here. A strict skeletal fusion category C must be, so fusion of multiplicity one, which means that for all x, y, z simple object, Ohm space is at most one dimensional. Of course, this is just necessary condition being strict skeletal. It's not sufficient, but it is necessary, but not sufficient, of course. Of course. To be strict is skeletal. So now, let's see the main consequence of MacLane strictness theorem. The main consequence of MacLane strictness theorem, it is the coherence theorem. In some sense, the first big result in monoidal category theory. So, the coherence theorem. So, what is this theorem about? It's about associativity constraint. So, if you have a tensor product of several objects, you can apply the associativity constraint in several possible ways. So in a tensor product of more than three objects, there are several ways. So you can apply the associativity constraint in several ways. So there are several ways to apply the associativity constraint. Associativity constraint. So if you have a tensor product of four objects, you come back to the Pentagon equation. So let's rewrite it quickly like that. X4. Here you have two ways to apply the associativity constraint. You can apply one associativity constraint, so I don't write the details like that. Or you can apply one associativity constraint with some identities like that. Tensor some identities. So this will be stated correctly. And here you can again apply some associativity constraint and you get like that. X2 tensor, X3 tensor, X4. And here again, associativity constraint and some identities. You get that X2. X3, X4. And again, you can apply here. So there is two ways to apply the associativity constraint to get from there to there. One way with this isomorphism F, and one other way with this isomorphism G. But the Pentagon axiom says that F equals G. The coherence theorem says that this is also this work if you have a product of more than four objects. Coherence theorem. So this is okay here by Pentagon axiom. And by coherence theorem, that it's also okay. So if you have two ways, like F and G, they will be equal with more than four objects. So more precisely. Precisely, so let's state the coherence theorem precisely. Okay. Let's see. Be a monoidal category. Monoidal category x1 up to xn in C. P1, P2 to parenthesized. So to parenthesized. Sized product. So two ways of parenthesizing the tensor product x1, x2, xn. So you parenthesize these two. And this provides you two different objects, P1, P2. P1, P2. So let F G from P1 to P2, from the object P1 to the object P2, be two isomorphisms obtained as before by composing associativity constraint. Associativity constraint or inverse of associativity constraint and identities, then F equals G. So this is the exact statement of MacLane's strictness theorem. So this statement says that we don't need to care too much about the parentheses when you are doing computation in a monoidal category. So before stating that, so the proof C last semester's material. So this was done in session 10 or the book section 2.9. So as I said, what is the point of this theorem? So by coherence theorem, we can safely remove the parenthesis. The parenthesis. For computation in monoidal category. Okay. So this is it. Was the end of session, last semester session 10. Summary of last semester session 11. So last semester session 11 start with, so I will stop here because this is the end of, I guess it is the end. So the next week we will recall the notion of rigid monoidal categories. So for next week, see you next week. You next week. Okay, so I will stop here.